So hey everybody, everybody is bright-eyed and bushy-tailed on the first full morning of the Kraken, and we're here to talk about the upcoming Big Rubble and Pavis books through the lens of sandbox gaming and how to best effectuate that in play, and how as designers to design for sandbox gaming. For the benefit of YouTube, I am game designer and writer Robin D. Laws, and among my Glorantha credits are King of Dragon Pass and Six Ages mobile game, and the HeroQuest rule set, among among other things. And this is Jeff Richard, who is
the creative director and chairman of Chiasium. So, publisher of fine things like RuneQuest, HeroQuest, and Call of Cthulhu.
So I think the first thing that would be interesting to talk about is sandbox play itself, and what that is, and what influence has the Big Rubble had on the whole idea of sandbox play over the years, and as we're approaching this new version of the book, what we are thinking about sandbox play now after, what has it been, 35 years since the publication of the original?
We don't really want to think about how it's been. It's closer to 40, I think.
I think the Rubble is a landmark product, and among other things, in the way that it has established expectations for sandbox play. And it's interesting that it is, on a grand metaphorical level, is a sandbox. It is a arid section of sand and other materials surrounded by walls. It's literally, not literally, but close to, on a grand imagistic scale, a sandbox. And the expectation is that the characters will go into it and just start poking around, looking for something interesting to happen. And that's sort of the signature idea behind sandbox play. Although, like a lot of other role-playing terms, it has several meanings, depending on what people want it to be.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have as many meanings as railroading, thank goodness, but it has a couple of meanings anyway. Some people, I think, say sandbox to refer to anything where there is strong player agency, where the players are making decisions, and then the GM is essentially reacting to their decisions, as opposed to the more classic sort of, if you want to say, mission-style adventuring, where there's a premise at the top of the scenario, the GM has worked out what that is. There may be a whole bunch of different ways to get to the end, but at the beginning you know what your objective is, and through the rest of it you're kind of working toward that objective. Now that doesn't mean it has to be linear or without choice. Mother of Monsters scenario that you that is one of part of the Kraken chapbook series is not a sandbox adventure, but it's full of different options and gives you all sorts of ways to align with different forces or so forth. But at the end of the day, it's about a particular problem that you're expected to deal with. Whereas in sandbox play, the players are expected to find the problem that interests them. And that's why the Big Rubble is an archetypal environment to go and find interesting trouble. So Jeff, what is your relationship to the Big Rubble? What as a player?
The Big Rubble, well, I mean, my personal history on this is that the Big Rubble was actually our first real setting as when I got into role-playing games that felt like a real place. Previously, I had gotten into role-playing with games like
Metamorphosis. Jim Ward's game. I screw that word up every time.
Early AD&D, And in that, the setting and the location, you know, you would explore a place, but then if you turned around back on the and tried to retrace your path, the location might very well not exist. I remember complaining once to my GM that I felt like we were on a blank map, and the only place that existed is where the flashlight currently focused on. And then if we retraced, there was nothing. There was nothing there. It could be, you know, we had come from a town. We retrace our steps, and it could be a ruin. It could be a swamp or whatever. The rubble was the first place that we could explore, and if we found something, it stayed there. And so it was confined in location, and we spent a lot of time as players trying to poke around in this. And since in the original Big Rubble book, not that much is actually detailed.
Yes. Okay. So we've gotten to it. So the mission for the new Big Rubble book is to be the Big Rubble you remember, not the Big Rubble that it actually is when you open up the box and look at that old product, because it's 35 to 40 years old, and we've figured out some stuff since then. And could you pour me a water?
Oh, absolutely.
It actually kind of, a lot of it exists in a sort of nether space between source book, where it's kind of describing in a broad general way a lot of things from a very high elevation of what might be in the Big Rubble, and an adventure. So that in there's a couple of sections that are very highly detailed. The puzzle canal is sort of the archetypal weirdo dungeon environment, but in a lot of cases it will tell you that not much is known about this particular culture, and the answer that the new book has is, well, I'm going to tell you everything you need to know, GM, about that new culture, because the players may well go and ask. For example, there's the Mani tribe is mentioned, and they usually get like a little paragraph of, this is a mysterious cult that worships an ancestor who periodically reincarnates back into the tribe, and they're very conservative, and they have all of these important rules. That ain't enough. If my players go, Mani tribe, let's go see what they're all about, and our job is to not leave you hanging when they do that. And so the new book tells you what you need to know about the Mani tribe, and gives you their mythology, and tells you who the person is that you're going to talk to. They're insular, but it doesn't mean they never ever interact with anybody. So here's the person who talks to outsiders. Here's what they tell you if they learn to trust you a little more. And here's how to really earn their trust. So the whole idea of the rest of the book is to continue doing that. So the principle that you want to draw from that in terms of what's interesting and exciting about sandbox play is that everything that you encounter in an exciting, fun sandbox is an opportunity. That there's nothing that the players do that just sort of leads nowhere, but whatever they explore in the rubble is something that leads them to some other possibility. Now, they still choose, unlike a more traditional mission-focused game, whether they want to follow up on that opportunity and how. And ideally, you want to set things up so that everything they encounter and deal with has multiple ways that it could possibly go. So, for example, if they talk to the Mani tribe, it's the rubble, there's all these hostile groups, the sort of default way that anything can be interesting or go one way or the other is they can be hostile to you or they can be friendly to you. But more importantly, they can have specific things that that they send you to do. So the descriptions of the various cultures and the characters talks more about their agendas and what they really want and what they might want from adventurers. So that gives you, if you're friendly with them, they might tell you to go over and do this over here for them, and they'll give you that. And so, and that's something that's not that's only sort of implicit in little bits and pieces in the original book.
Oh, the original book is, and you and I have gone through it now quite an awful lot. There is a lot less in the original book than anybody remembers. And, you know, for instance, Trolltown or Temple Hill. I mean,
all these exciting locations. Blind King's Hill, all of these. There simply wasn't enough information there for a GM to really do much unless they wanted to do all the work on their own. And, you know, that's cool, and there should be some areas where people can do this, but, you know, the exciting places that all the signposts from the game is saying, you and your adventurers want to go here, and there's absolutely nothing about this anywhere in the book, is kind of, in today's world, kind of a little bit of a disappointment.
Right, especially in something that's based on improv, because it's not necessarily ideal, but sort of okay if you have a mission-focused game, and we haven't told you enough about the Mani tribe or the elves in order to do a mission involving them. But an improv play where the players, you may not expect at the beginning of the evening that they go, let's go talk to the Mani tribe, and you're like, okay, what? So the book has to supply the answers to those in order to facilitate it, to take that burden off of you of making up stuff about the world on the fly, so that you can better deal with the issue of what are the characters going to want from this group, and what interesting opportunity to do something fun can arise out of them.
And one of the things that's fun in a sandbox setting, and certainly the material that Robin's been putting together, is the idea of it being a dynamic sandbox. So Pavis, the Big Rubble, is not a static place. Or
especially
Pavis.
Now.
Yes, especially now. And so one of the things that I think is really interesting in it with a sandbox is, and it's a complaint I have a lot about a lot of video games. Right? We play the sandbox in a computer game, you go around and you go to the town and nothing has changed. You know, despite the fact that you've spent all this effort doing stuff, very little has changed actually in the environment. And in a role-playing game, it's a lot easier for us to do a dynamic feedback. Players do something, and they change the environment within the Big Rubble, but there's also stuff going on externally, which
right.
Maybe...
And so I guess this is what brings us to what is the change in the Rubble, and the change is our graph has taken over Pavis. And there's a different life path system in the Big Rubble book, if you want to use that. So if you're starting your RuneQuest campaign in the Big Rubble, you create new characters for that purpose. And in contrast with the existing one, this is much more, you have been through the wars. The assumption is that you're veterans of the war on Argrath's side, and you may have started out fighting with for the Azrolians or Broyan or
we could have even been a wolf pirate.
Statistically in a group of six, some of you will have been wolf pirates. So you've seen the whole world and you have been on the boat with Herrick and you've survived that, and consequently you are the characters in classic westerns who have survived the Civil War, and you have this. You've been kind of maybe broken by the war. You've maybe, one of the options in one of the life path things is that when you met Herrick, you angered him, so he ripped off your arm, but then he thought you took it so well that he had magic done to put your arm back on. So you've seen some stuff, man.
And that's one of the milder bits of things you may have experienced.
Yes, it's possible to have both the loyal to Herrick and fears Herrick passions. And now, so Argrath is in a holding pattern. He wants to, this is the phase where he's sort of gathering the crazy new magic, the incompatible magics from different cultures, and finding a way to fuse them together into a battlefield weapon. So he's kind of on a pause mode in Pavis, gathering his strength as he's going to start pushing on into the rest of Sartar and all the other Sartarite cities. And so what does he do with this vast force of hardened, perhaps somewhat traumatized and or lunatic soldiers in this interim period? Well, the answer is he doesn't want to pay them. He's a king and he needs his money for other things.
But he doesn't want to dismiss them.
He doesn't want to dismiss them. A bunch of the Praxians have already ridden off, and they'll come back. He's White Bull. But a bunch of them are now running around the rubble, and so are you. And so in a bit of a callback to a classic part of the original book, Argrath gives everybody, all of his soldiers, a charter to exploit a particular territory in the rubble. So you have all rights to dig up stuff and earn treasure in whatever plot that he happens
to. And you're the law there.
Yeah, you're the law. Well, the question is, what enforcement powers do you have?
Because whatever you wish.
because many of the things that he gives you are occupied by other people. So if you get the charter to Blind King's Hill, do you go and knock on the door and tell the undead inside that you're the new sheriff in town? The players in my group discovered that skeletons shoot arrows at you when you do that. And they've also discovered it's root quests and arrows are bad. So the adventure that's going to be, the intro adventure that's going to be in the book is basically the old Flintnail Temple, not the current one, but the ones that the dwarves used to have is now occupied by a bandit clan, and you've got the charter to that. Now, of course, as GM, you can decide to give them a charter to anything that you find interesting, but this gives them a bit of a dilemma in that, well, there's bandits in my in our fort, and a fort is like, that's pretty good. You got a really great charter.
And it's a dwarf-built fort.
A dwarf-built fort, but there's people in it. What do you do with them? And so they initially go, oh, bandits, we'll clear them out, and then you go and you meet them and go, oh, and there's women and children living there, and it's a whole community, and there's the elves, and they're... But you're bandits, and the answer is, well, so are you. It's like, oh yeah, you got a point there. So the intro adventure revolves around the moral dilemma of, do you drive them out? Do you, they don't recognize your authority, but they say, oh, you seem kind of impressive though. If you work hard enough for us, we might let you into our clan. Do you do that? Do you take that from them? And so one way or another, you wind up with a base of operations, and then you start wondering, well, now what do I do? You know, however you get that fort, or you decide to go, well, to heck with that, let's go trade our charter for another charter and see what else is going on in town. And so right away, this confronts the players with the question, what am I going to do? What am I going to try and build? How am I going to make something more of myself during this phase where we're waiting for Argrath to act? And that brings us to the next sort of principle of sandbox play. My partner in crime, Kenneth Hite, describes sandbox play as the GM buries the dinosaurs, and it's up to the players to dig them up. And then what they do with the dinosaurs is up to them. So the process of building out and detailing the setting has been one of making sure there's lots of dinosaurs, and the dinosaur is the plot that the players decide to follow. There is a story arc that you can work toward that is suggested in it. Do we want to?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. When I pitched this project to Jeff, I said, so what's at the bottom of the rubble? What's under the rubble? And Jeff explained.
Well, there is the Eye of Wekboth, way down deep beneath the Devil's Marsh. And this is part of the issue. So a little backup for people that have had fan discussions going about Pavis for years and years. How much do we, I don't think we do, we pretty much will give it up on the idea and that was a fan theory in the 90s of all these Green Age experiments and whatnot, right? And so I haven't actually looked at that part there. But there's the Eye of Wekboth beneath this. And when you look at the map there, right, we know that Wekboth the Devil got squished in beneath the block. But there are parts of Wackbath that got scattered around. And one of the pieces that isn't underneath the block is his eye. And that
right
throws it to Robin.
So as we begin, virtually no one knows that the eye is somewhere under the rubble. And it allows you to specify, provide you as GM several options of where it could possibly be, how it manifests, and I think one of the likely things that players are going to do is they're going to look at Ogre Island and see that it's covered in dry brambles and go, what happens when Ogre Island? That sounds like a better place to attack than this fortress full of bandits who are, if not sympathetic, no less skeeving than we are. Ogres, they sound bad. Let's go over to Ogre Island. And
Eat people.
They eat people.
Clear-cut moral.
Yeah.
it's clearly moral to kill the ogres.
Right. Now, of course, the ogres are too smart to be hanging around on Ogre Island. That would give them away. But there's a whole bunch of dry bramble and stuff that renders it essentially impassable. And the question that my players have immediately asked, and perhaps other generations of past players, is, well, why don't we set all that on fire? And it could be that setting the Chaos Island on fire releases a plume of smoke that goes up in the sky and looks kind of like an eye. And the players may realize that something they do or something somebody else does begins to release the Eye of Wackbath. And that's bad news for everybody, especially for Argrath, who's telling... He says I took care of Chaos. I wiped it out when we invaded the city and
got rid of the Lunars.
Got rid of the Lunars. Took Gim the Grim and beheaded him and threw the body in the Elf Garden because Argrath is obviously relying on the previous big rubble where you don't get to interact with the elves. But this version, they can interact with you, and they're not happy about that. So this gives you a big arc that you can work toward, that the players can feel like they discovered and can attack in various different ways. So it still isn't a timeline of events, as you will get in later things that deal more directly with the war, but rather, here's an idea that you can play with, that you can mess with.
And it also is one where, as the players become increasingly aware of other things going on in the rubble, like the Eye of Wackbath, some of the decisions that they made early on about their charter may come back to haunt them.
Yes.
You know, if players at a certain point may come to the conclusion, oh, it's actually important to have local allies that know more about what's going on in the rubble, that have more of a history here. Maybe we shouldn't have wiped them all out. Or, you know, boy, wouldn't it be useful for us to have a friendly relationship with the elves? Maybe we shouldn't have burnt down that part of the garden in order to find our treasure. And that's something I really like, because I one of my favorite, my usual approach in running a game, and it reflects in all the material that I put together for RuneQuest or other games, is the bulk of the story comes from the consequences of the player's success. So success, if I'm your GM, success is often a worse thing than failure, because success always comes at all sorts of prices that you have to start paying afterwards. You know, the story doesn't end when you've cleared out bandit, the old Flint Nail fort. That's actually the beginning of the story. And the how you did this, you know, how you managed to get what it was that your characters all thought was so important, that is the seed for the future stories. That's where the conflict is created. And it works very well in a sandbox, because you have lots of things to throw at the players and for the players to bounce back against.
So when you're designing your own sandbox setting, one of the techniques that I would recommend is that you think in terms of activating the elements in the setting. And mm-hmm. place is a thing that you want to write as something that activates, so that when you go there, something happens, an opportunity arises. And so one thing that you want to avoid is something that occasionally happens in the original Big Rubble, which is, says, here's this very interesting, fascinating place, and you can't go there. And the elf garden is one of the examples of that, where, in fact, there's not a single actual elf described. There's the elf defensive system is described, and then mostly the elf section is a list of weird plants. In that sort of,
and if you go in here, you will die. The elves will just fill you up with arrows.
Right.
And, so don't go there.
Right.
It's cool though.
Yeah, it's cool. And we're gonna. And so in the new version, of course, well, of course, if the players decide they really want to talk to the elves, you as GM aren't going to shut that down. They're making a choice. They're doing something in the sandbox. So the elf garden is a place that is activated. And it says, well, it's very difficult to get into the garden. The elves are insular and highly defensive, but you may have a great access point, because also chances are one of the players has a sort of runic connections that the elves love, and is exactly their kind of person.
Go Arnalda.
Yeah, go Arnalda. And so it now provides you the list of the elf leadership, and it tells you who their spokesman is, who might actually talk to you, and what it is that they want to do, and they want to do a bunch of things. They're mad at Argrath for throwing the chaos corpse into their garden. But they're also wondering who do we set up our herb trade back with. So there's a bunch of different things that you can go. And of course, every major faction in the rubble is angry at every other major faction in the rubble. And so
like, what's the easiest way to make the elves happy with you?
You can kill the trolls.
Kill the trolls.
Kill the trolls.
Of course, on the other hand, if you do that, then you've got a problem with the trolls, who are another big faction.
Right. And they're, as per the original, fun because they're divided faction. So if you get one group of the trolls mad at you, you go talk to the other group of the trolls and get something going between them. And those characters who, again, all get like a line of dialogue or a line of description in the original book now get full descriptions and stats. Mm-hmm. And that brings me to the next thing you activate, activating character. So not only do you want to give the characters that they may meet agendas and a reason to want to interact with them. So all the descriptions of all the factions are, well, here's why they might be receptive to an approach, and here's what they might want from the adventurers. Here are the conditions where that might happen, and also it gives you more of more characterization to work with than we're used to seeing in RuneQuest and Glorantha products, where typically the description of a character is, here's what they look like. They hate dwarves and like elves, and often that's all traditionally we've gotten, and that makes those characters
Very 2D.
2D, hard to play, because what do you actually do with that? It's hating dwarves is not an agenda, and liking elves is not a personality trait. And so now you're getting much more information on how to play this character. So it gives you mannerisms that you might want to adopt. It describes their voice. It gives a more detailed appearance. And so it gives you all the tools as a GM. If you're suddenly surprised to find out that they're talking to the Lorachek clan of trolls tonight, when you thought they were going to be going off and talking to the undead on Blind King's Hill, you have the tools you need to quickly embody that character. Now, you might not necessarily want to speak in the funny voice that it suggests or use a mannerism, but it gives you something that you can either accept or reject.
And this is one of the things that's really important in whenever you have a sandbox setting is, as a GM, you've got to be able to have, you know, because a sandbox is premised on the ideas that the players may go in any direction, you've got to have that material there so that the GM can respond for it going in any direction, especially with RuneQuest, because RuneQuest has a lot of moving pieces to it.
Yeah. And that brings us to something that's very specific to a Glorantha sandbox that is not necessarily going to be an issue in other sandbox campaigns you create, which is activating history. So we have this vast, fascinating 1,500-year history of the big rubble that starts in the Green Age when it's a lush and verdant forest, and it then gets burned down by oak fed in the lesser darkness, and chaos comes, and then there's sort of a fallow period, and then giants show up, and then shortly thereafter the god learners appear, and then this happens, and there's this very long detailed history that even goes through all the fate of the Pavasites after the fall of their city, and then on to the modern day. And traditionally there's no particular way to interact with that as
Correct.
Adventurers. You're just like, yeah, that's all. I don't know about that. And
here's a three-page essay.
Here's a three-page essay from no discernible point of view.
Right.
That a lot of the Gwent, it's not, it's almost an omniscient narrator, except that omniscient narrator is doesn't know a bunch of stuff. Sometimes they know a lot about something, and sometimes the unidentified narrator, who's not even necessarily Lancre Mai, but you know, maybe this is a document from the Sixth Age, who knows? And he's like, and then there's an altar of Ifenbix, and we just don't know much about that, except that it was, well, the players might know something about it because they might run into it. And more importantly, there's a bunch of people in the rubble who remember the golden age of Pavis. They were there. They're not necessarily going around telling everybody about it because they don't care that much, but there are people you can go and talk to who can tell you who are there from their history, from their point of view. Therefore, the new presentation is all about presenting the history of the setting from not one objective, omniscient point of view, but a myriad of different subjective points of view. So each major faction, they tell you the story of their people. So basically it starts out, there's common knowledge, just what any shopkeeper in Pavis knows about dwarves, for example, let's say, and then adventurer knowledge. Adventurers know a bunch more stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that gives you the basic recap on dwarves, which you can then paraphrase and explain to players who are new to Glorantha. And that's sort of the standard stuff. And then it goes a big section that's called The Way the Dwarves Tell It. And this gives you the their story of the dwarves from the beginning of the creation of the earth to the history of this particular group of dwarves in this particular place. And it tells you the story from their point of view as those particular characters might explain it to the adventurers if the adventurers bother to ask. And this is repeated again and again for the different factions. So there's the troll version, which of course their history in the rubble doesn't start until the second wave of conquest of the city. And here's the version from the point of view of the Mani tribe, if you go and talk to them. And there's this other weird group of people running around with tattoos of eyes in the middle of their foreheads, and they have a new revelation that they've just gotten that according to them, all of known history is kind of wrong and misunderstood from another direction, and here's the story the way that they tell it. And this is an actual way to convey all of that great wadge of exposition to the players in play.
In digestible amounts
in the context of something that they actually care about.
And this is one of the issues with Glorantha as a setting. Glorantha is a phenomenally rich setting, and most Gloranthophiles get very, very excited about the richness of the setting, and they more often than we care to admit make the mistake, and it is a mistake, to go to a new players and try to download for them a 4 to 12 page essay on the history of the setting. And it either turns other players off, or it just, too much information. And what I really like about the approach that Robin's taken this is it's all that information is there, but it's all in digestible pieces. And so if the players want to put together the full story, they have to talk to everybody, which is also something that I think is fantastic, is encourage people to go to other places and get other stories from it. But also it gives that information and the richness of the setting, but in a player and GM friendly manner.
Right, and because players are much more likely to retain the parts of the setting that actually are germane to the to what it is that they want to do. And this brings us to another thing that is activated within the setting, and that is objects. I think one of our favorite chapters so far is one called History as Loot. And what this does is it, even if you go and talk to all of the groups in the setting, they all have their own particular version of history, but there are some gaps in the story. But if the players happen to acquire, either by digging up a fabulous item or dry gulching someone else and taking that item, they then want to figure out what it is. And so there's a whole group of magical artifacts that are described in this chapter that date back from the Green Age on up through every different phase of Big Rubble history, and then it gives you the digestible chunk of information that you will get if you go to an expert, whether at the Lankermai Temple or a relic dealer, what they will tell you about what the subject is. So you know there are shields dating back from the God's War. There are Uroxi shields from the battle against Wakbath.
Yeah,
one of those up. And that'll tell you a lot about the setting, right? Or during the age where the giants were ruling the city, there's a bunch of artifacts. There's there's an length of rope that cannot be cut by any normal means, and it's one of the hairs from the giant's head.
Right,
or
right.
There's a dagger made from his fingernail.
And what's really great about this is that this is another way. So you know, Robin was talking about sandbox. And normally, what people treat a sandbox, they focus on locations and individuals. But with a setting as rich as Glorantha, there's another sandbox there to explore, and that's the lore of the setting itself. And so this is a way to basically encourage players to learn more about the setting, but again, it's in a digestible manner, and it's through their cool items that they are so proud of. So if you manage to get some cool artifact that once belonged to a troll warlord that has got its own history to it, the players are going to care about that history. And they're going to care about it much more and be much more likely to use that as a launch board to doing other things and other forms of interaction than they are with an essay. And this is something it's definitely my favorite section in it. And it's one of these ones where it's like, duh, why didn't I ever think of doing that? I mean, the seeds of it are in Plunder.
Yeah.
Because if you remember in the old RQ product Plunder, it had the information, the myth associated with it, and the history of the item. But like so many of the brilliant ideas in the early days of RuneQuest, it floated around in the ether, and nobody ever did much with it.
And now, right,
and Robin Hans.
Yeah, and for example, one of the traditional things from Big Rubble that I'm ignoring for more salubrious gameplay is the idea that the best source of information is the Lankermai Temple, and they charge you a lot of money for little factoids.
Yeah,
which are not that valuable. It's like, do I want to know this rumor about this pyramid, or do I want leg armor? I think I want leg armor. So I don't know if how many people actually had their characters pay large amounts of money.
Well, and what's worse about it is, on the other hand, there was another, in the old days, there was another chart on, well, how much does it, so this is how much it costs me to ask the Lankermai cult this question, which they come up with this marginally useful rumor. Or, for less money, I can have them cast a rune spell, which will give me far more detailed information that comes from the God of Truth and is absolutely right.
Yes.
And, or I can have leg armor.
Yes. And as a GM, you want to have as many ways to seamlessly give information to the players as possible. And that's another stopping point where the characters are refusing to cooperate with your effort to supply exposition to the players. So we have a few minutes left to throw it to questions.
Yeah, anybody got some questions here? Tough crowd. Oh.
Yeah, of all the dynamic sandbox, the question that rises in my head is, who's driving the dynamic? Is it something set up in the background so that if some certain point something will happen, or is it driven by the actions of the players?
Sandbox, I think, by definition, mm-hmm. is that the players are driving the action, even though you may have, you know, it's back to the burying the dinosaurs metaphor, that you've got a possible thing that will happen that when they start poking around, and you might, you know, give them more than one hint to go in that direction. But that is one thing that they might do, and you're going to be equally prepared for them to be interested in something else. So, for example, the players in my group, it looks like they're either going to follow up on the Eye of Wakba thing or attempt to establish a banking financial center at Zebra Fork.
And as one does.
As one does. And so one of those things I had in mind and the other I didn't. And both can lead to all sorts of interesting things, but I wanted the players to feel like they are driving the action. Now, as a bit of an asterisk, my players, I think, prefer a mission-focused setup because I think they're often sort of have a little challenge negotiating what they'll all do next. And so they, I think, kind of prefer more of a gumshoe sort of system of here's the case of the week. So, when that happens, you may decide to be a more active driver of things and to hint more strongly in the direction of something that mm-hmm. will move them somewhere. But the default idea with Sandbox anyway is that you are just giving them a whole bunch of opportunities to go places and then reacting to them, that the players are in the driver's seat and you as game master are kind of scrambling to stay one step ahead of them.
And from time to time, you know, you've got to, you know, when the players are stumped, that's a good time to put out something where, mm-hmm. oh, you know, because you actually have a lot of potential mission givers as well. First and foremost being, you've got Argrath there in New Pavis himself, you know, it's, oh, okay, well, the players now are really stumped here. Okay, well, now we can give out a mission here. But that'll be for him, but there's another book that has much more pushback in consequences, but that's the next book, so we'll talk about that next year.
Yeah. Another point about Sandbox is that because it is a term about player agency, I think a lot of players will tell you, yeah, I really want every setting to be a sandbox. But it turns out that they don't necessarily.
But they usually want it a mix.
Yes. Again, know what your players are talking about when they say sandbox. But because it's easier to default back to a mission focus, as Jeff has just said, than it is to turn a mission focused game into a sandbox.
So your players won't be the only ones out there with a charter. And the worst thing you can inflict on a player group is a group that's effectively a different group of players. So do you have this information?
It's essentially implicit in the setting, right? That so one of the suggestions is, if you don't like your charter, maybe you run into somebody else and they are running down away from their whoever occupies their chunk of land.
I'm not talking about their charter. I'm talking about the group having that charter and doing stuff with that.
Yes, there's a whole big section on other veterans in the rubble, and some of them have already possess areas. Others are like you, are running around. So yes, there are.
Some may end up becoming allies. Some are very much likely to come into conflict with you.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they're an interestingly diverse group of folk there.
Yes. The person who's now running the real city, she's now coffee, because the dregs of the whole all of Glorantha are in Arngrath's army, and she's running it very effectively, but you don't want to cross her.
Well, and this is the other thing on this is you run into these other veterans, and you might want to screw with them, they might want to screw with you, whatever, but there is a big boss. And that's the last thing to put about is there's this wonderful bit about meeting with the white bull. And it's, is going to the white bull, is that a thing that the players are going to find easy to do and non-threatening?
They know him personally, and it's still scary.
The court of Argrath is, Argrath has many skills. Institutional bureaucracy is definitely not one of
yes.
them. and his court is surrounded, you know, it's madmen, it's killers, it's fanatics,
right.
It's Praxian warlords.
Oiled up dancing boys.
Yeah. Whatever. And they, you know, a visit to the court is an adventure in its own right.
Yes, and you'll probably get severely stoned from all the
secondhand
hashish and hazia and drug use in the rubble. There's a big sidebar on that,
like the Berlin book.
Yeah.
What's the do you extend the relationship between the rubble and the rest of the world? Because one of the things that I found with the kind of original big rubble was that for all that it sits within the world, it's pictured as this very isolated place. And yet there's so much there that should relate to kind of everything else.
Well, it'll get everybody's attention if the Eye of Wachboth rises from underneath the city. One of the things that Jeff points out from looking at the maps is that actually Pavis is pretty close to Sardar, and it's not... This is not Argrath sort of practicing on a little starter city backwater in the middle of nowhere. This is the launching pad for the whole rest of the drive into
yes.
Sartar.
So, well, into Dragon Pass itself.
Dragon Pass itself. So it is a crucial strategic asset that right. where things are just beginning to bubble up and to move into place for that, so that the players and what they discover in the rubble in terms of finding things, like, for example, the God Learner mirror, that if they put it together, they can step through into the other side, wind up in a random myth in a station somewhere. If they get back, Argrath will want to see them, and he might even like clear the dancing boys out of the way in order to listen to you about it. So,
well, and this is the final last thing, and then I think we're going to run out of money, is that all of this then ties in with another book, which is the RuneQuest campaign, because unlike one of the things in the old Pavis book is that people got the impression, well, the Lunars are always there. It always just kind of continues more or less the way it is presented in these books. Argrath isn't going to be there for very long. This is his springboard for his campaign. And very likely, if you play a Pavis-centered game, at some point, Argrath will leave. Because he's not, the launching pad, and anytime you have a launching pad, at some point, you have a launch.
There's a launch. And the person he leaves behind in charge of Pavis has not been canonically determined. So you determine it in play, and your players determine it in play. So could be their worst enemy. Could be their best patron, or it could be one of them that winds up running the city even. And it's because this is a dynamic setting, once he goes, it will be radically different, because all the veterans described in the veterans chapter, except for a few left behind to kind of guard the store from rear guard action, they're going to be gone. And all of the...
As will the 10,000 or so Praxian nomads.
And so all of the people who you've been happily oppressing and looting, they're going to be...
The balance of power, you know, has been... There's not that much... there's an army of nomads, wolf pirates, and adventurers.
Right.
That greatly outnumbers the local inhabitants. But when that army is gone, you know, all that's left is the rear, suddenly that playing field becomes a little bit more even, and your players may find some decisions that made a lot of sense early on now are going to bite them on the ass. And it, which to me is a wonderful source of new stories.
And already the population is completely different than it was the last time you saw a Pappas book.
Yes.
All the Lunars have been driven out.
Everybody with a bad name is gone?
Yes. Everyone with a stupid pun name died. They were horribly killed. And on that note, thanks for coming and listening to us.
That means we will also get an update of new pages.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Big Rubble, also new pages.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yes, it's a two-book set.
It's 2 books. Okay, thank you, guys. Short break, and then I'll talk about maps. Yep. Thank you, Robin.